explain some. So I'll explain the first one, which is the introduction, and that's because, can I sit down on that? Is that okay? I'm going to talk about an ESLC project called Sociology of Values and Value. The research question was, is there anything beyond capital? It's quite a big question, but an important one. Have we been enclosed, captured, transducted? Are we aware? Does it matter? And I began with two different projects, one on posterity theology and one on Facebook. I chose the two areas because I knew absolutely nothing about either. So it's a challenge for me to learn about stuff. I'll begin by looking at unknotting paradigms, where to face, how we get trapped by them. Then I'll show how we found a methodology, connecting theory and method. Then I'll look at how we began to untangle the analysis of previous work. I'll then draw on, and this is where it gets a bit complex, different historical legacies for personhood and how that differentiates persons through Facebook. And then I'll look at how Facebook monetizes friendship and traps us in, completely traps us in. And then I'll attack all the ideas about free labor, which basically is the dominant paradigm in any understanding of social media. And then I'll go through the project which used custom-built software as if we got into Facebook to interrogate Facebook. It was a nightmare, and I'll do a bit on that. And then I want to say I'm using Kostas Lapavitsas, who wrote a brilliant book called Profiting Without Producing, to understand how Facebook circulates capital and hence why it's very important to think about its future role. So that's the project itself. There is a website and we do put things up on it and you can get all the kind of information from it. So the first question, as I said, was, is anything beyond capital? And you can kind of see the argument here, but as we progressed through, we really hadn't a clue about how difficult it would be to research Facebook. Only 5% of research on social media is on Facebook, mostly done with Facebook data scientists, and most of it is quantitative survey stuff, apart from their own manipulating experiment on affect that they did recently. So it's very, very limited research, actually, very limited research. So when I began, obviously it's an area I don't know anything about, I think, well, what do I read, where do I face, who do I speak to? And that's what I think is interesting about disciplines, because if you look at this list, scan it very quickly, I'm not going to go through it, is that most of the people working on social media are actually they're already trans or intradisciplinary. They're not disciplinary at all. They come from cultural studies, media, software studies, philosophy, Marxism. They come from so many different traditions. Now, I showed this to Roger Burrows, who's listed on there, who ran the massive e-projects in the 1990s and 2000s, and he said, I'd write an entirely different list. So it's quite interesting to think about how do we locate ourselves, but the most important thing is who do we really want to speak to and what issues are we addressing? So I'm saying it became it's like, I wouldn't advise anybody to think, oh, I'll just research that, I don't know, in so many ways. But, you know, I'm getting there in the end. So then we had to think what particular methodology, what theory and methods, what particular methods would we use? And we did begin, because we were, you know, we were alert to loads of things. I'm an old researcher, so I'm alert to lots of different frames, and I'm thinking which ones would be the most appropriate and which ones should we use. So Lefebvre, I thought, was the most appropriate, because he looks at rhythm analysis as it moves in and out of different forms. And so he could easily look at protocols. I think that most social media is about rhythms of movement, encroachment upon time and things like that. So we thought he'd be very, very appropriate. And then we came across two of my colleagues, actually, Sarah Kemper and Joanna Zelinsky's book. And they talk about understanding lifeness. And they work on social media. They work on all visual media, really, more than anything else. And they look at, instead of traditionally is not the right word to use with social media, but most social media is studied through what's called real-time research, or life methods, or big quants, big data quants. But we thought what they did was much more interesting, and it fits with Lefebvre, that they look at lifeness, and their question is, how does Facebook move through people's lives? Because there's a huge amount of technological determinism, you know, in understanding social media. Algorithms are God, and in some sense they are, and protocols determine our use. And I do think the term platformativity is quite important, because platforms do make us do things. You know, we just don't go onto Facebook and determine how we use it. It is making us respond in particular ways. But there's lots of other things going on in our lives, other rhythms. So there's big debates going on in these areas, and that's what I wanted to kind of look at. So that's how we came, kind of the theoretical frame, the methodological frame as we move into it. Now the most important thing I wanted to do was to see how people were using Facebook, and I'll explain this later on. So Simon Yule was employed on the project, who was a genius geek, I call him, who designed all the custom-built software plugins, and I'll go through that in a minute. But before I do, I want now to look at, very, very briefly, histories of personhood. So that was the introduction. I'm now going to do one slide of histories of personhood. And I do put books on the bottom, which isn't an egotistical gesture. It's just that there's a whole book that took 7 years to write on this issue, which I've squashed into one PowerPoint slide. So that's why it's there. And then another article that's kind of pointing to the future by exploring person value. So I want to look from the histories of possessive individuals and the liberal social contract in Europe in the 17th century to kind of work through into ideas about selves that we have now. And a lot of the selves that we have now, including Bourdieu's ideas about selves, are about the disposition to accumulate. And there's great books from Paul Degay and Nick Rose talking about how the enterprising subject is the subject of our neoliberal moment. There's also great work by Marilyn Strathern and Charles Taylor on the incitement to compulsory individuality. We all have to perform as if. As if is the phenomenological important term here. As if individuals. And then for me, one of the most important theories I found that was from work on reality TV, which is very significant to Facebook, was the new imperative to perform. We have to perform our value in order to authorise ourselves. So we don't just have to enterprise ourselves. We don't just have to accumulate as we move through the future with different capital, social, symbolic, cultural, economic. We have to show that we've accrued value. We have to show that we've enterprised up. And that's why I say I think reality TV is very important, because reality TV is a site where the limit to the subjective value is performed. Advertising, that's where it actually makes profits through selling your data, that which it controls through proprietary rights. It does this through, I've put out quite a lot of the ways, but it's actually brilliant at how it does it. The news feed, sponsored stories, likes, shares, everything. It's getting shown up. It is absolutely brilliant in terms of what it does. Click-throughs, all sorts of adverts. Phenomenal stuff. But what's very interesting, there's a really, really brilliant book by Robert Gell where he looks at the design of the software. And right from the very, very start, Facebook's software was based on advertising design templates. Kirsten Arola's stuff shows how when they started developing it after their very first initial, let's get everybody together at the University of Stanford, it then went for advertising. So advertising is its basic raison d'etre, that's what it does. The other thing that's very key to the argument, and it's made by Robinson, is that because it's an advertising oligopoly, it circulates capital in the same way as the traditional advertising industry does. It doesn't make profit from surplus value. It's circulating capital continually. It's an advertising company. The other interesting thing about Facebook is it very rarely pays tax. So it managed to pay £4,327 last year, whilst claiming that at least a third of the people are on it. So like any of those massive companies, they don't bother paying tax. And Peter Thiel, one of the Facebook founders, actually believes that's a really, really good thing. And he set up PayPal to make sure he didn't, you know, he could launder money across boundaries. So that's what they do. Significantly, and this is why I think they're so incredibly important, is they are a junction point. They've become a mini web. Everything goes through them. They're a global ecology. And practically everything that happens on the internet now is connected in some way or another to Facebook. And the most important thing Facebook does now, and it admitted it on the 15th of October this year, after denying it for the last 2 years, is it tracks you on every site that has a Facebook API, or if you see the little Facebook sign, the F in the blue background, that means you're being tracked when you're booking airline tickets, when you're booking any tickets actually, usually. When you're looking at anything, Facebook is tracking you. And its ability to track you is much more important than the Facebook platform. Now, the Facebook platform is nearly irrelevant to what Facebook does. It's its tracking capacity that is its strength, because as it tracks you, it does kind of basic behavioral economics and it builds up a profile of what you do. What it uses the Facebook platform to do is to actually add that into a biographical profile so they get a better picture of you so they can match you and sell you to advertisers. I'll show how it does this when we look at the software itself. But it is its phenomenal power. Facebook is now expanding globally, massively. It's got drone technology, it's going into Chinese banking, it's always the first one that does this. Because it's the first one, it builds up the capacity, nobody else can use it. As soon as it goes into a market, it then controls the market through its proprietary rights. It's already beginning to control online banking in China. It goes into India through SIM cards and what. It is phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. I wrote a book on the political economy of media in 1992. No, I couldn't have imagined this would happen. I mean, it's just incredible, quite incredible. And really what's very significant is that Facebook operates as a test. It's experimenting on your data and how much it can sell it for and how quickly it can sell it for, to whom, for the time. All the time it's experimenting. So it has the power to just play with people's data that nobody else can do. Google will be doing that in terms of search, but Facebook does it much more in terms of the profile that you've offered them on the platform and all your behaviour elsewhere. So very, very, very important. Now, I'm doing a little tangent here, which is about kind of untying some of the analysis that's already been made. But I do think it's important. Most people have understood social media as free labour. It's either the free labour that's been given by the open source developers or the free labour that you give by using the platform. I don't think it's free labour at all. I think that's actually barking up the wrong tree, partly because it's an advertising industry that circulates capital. It isn't a productive industry that produces surplus. It takes the surplus that's been produced from elsewhere in order to circulate it. And, you know, I could go into a really kind of detailed argument here, right? There isn't a labour theory of value because there is no labour. And all those kind of really big details about it. I think the most important thing for this paper is that the data that is given, your personal data, is given freely. There is no compulsion for you to use Facebook apart from if you want to show how many friends you have, or you want to connect people, or you want to perform your value, or maybe you just feel that you have to be connected. But it's not, you're not going to starve if you don't use Facebook. Your children aren't going to starve if you don't use Facebook. There is no compulsion to labour. For me, that's the absolute key. The other thing, and that's in the paper, is that Facebook is very different in terms of time. It's not labour time, but it's what we would call live time. Again, existing in the realm of circulation, not in the realm of production.
You see, that's your story. Those are kind of traditional adverts that go on, sponsored stories. And then in the background, Facebook is actually pulling off and putting on adverts. We didn't expect we'd find that, but that's when we started. We said, what's the mess? What's the mess? So we've got big servers kind of recording this data. If you see it on this one, I'm not sure whether you can see it as well, but this is the kind of level of interactivity that's going on. These patterns go on for days and days and days, and people who are registered with the project can actually follow their own patterns.
so they know who they're communicating with and what they're doing. So it's quite difficult to break down, but it's the grey matter that's really, really significant. So I just wanted to show you that. This one is the news feed. So we're controlling and looking at people's use of the news feed. And what you see is how people spend time looking at the news feed, which is the long pattern, but then how stories keep being added to the news feed at the top. So those are the very, very long lines. And this became really significant because we saw how Facebook was completely manipulating people's news feed. So it wasn't what they thought they were looking at. All of these things are what Facebook put on news feeds. People would scroll through, try to ignore them, then put them back again. So we watched how Facebook was literally putting things on people's news feeds that most people weren't that interested in, but then keep putting them back on. So that one there, as you can see, carried on for 6 days with Facebook putting stuff back on people's news feeds all the time. Because they wanted them to pay attention to those things, not what other people wanted. Now the next one, I'm not sure how well you can see this, but this is when we started looking into the grey matter. What we saw was how all the keyword matching was going on. Simon divided, he is a total genius. He devised what he called a heuristic device that pulled off 6 million advertising words, and then he organised them all through patterns to find out what was on everybody's site. So these are the keywords that he finds particular people's use. And then the pink dots are where Facebook is matching those words. And actually, we suspect, we don't know at this point, selling them on. But Facebook is on there paying attention. Now, it's not likely to be on your site matching things unless it's key. What we'll never know is how much it sells them for, because that all occurred on a real-time bidding site, which we can't get access to at all, and the ESRC didn't tell me to do. But what we can see from this is that they're paying a great attention to the detail of where you're looking elsewhere. None of those sites there are Facebook sites. They all come from tracking elsewhere from the grey matter. So they come from sites that people have been on when they're looking to buy wine at Asda or a lot of train tickets. A lot of train tickets on most people's sites, interesting. So the research findings from that, really, and I'd argue our data strength comes from doing lots of different analysis of different features, interactions, networks, news feed, word use and tracking. We found that Facebook's completely manipulating people's communication. Nobody thinks this. They think they're putting stuff on newsfeed. But you are likely to be connected to the most influential people and the people who are going to likely encourage you to buy stuff. They shape your network over time. They shape how you interact with whom, when, and how. They're constantly tracking you. You can never turn Facebook off. And they're constantly collating to match ad words, as you saw on the side there, to add to your profile. And they're constantly experimenting with matching. Now this became really, really interesting for us. Now their USP is the fact that they can do all of us. What's interesting, the Belgian government at the moment, and if anybody can explain why the Belgian government's so good, are trying to prosecute Facebook for doing all this tracking. They've got 5 US computer science departments trying to evidence it all, so we're going to kind of submit our research there. But what's significant is how they never leave you alone. You cannot log off Facebook. Even if you think you've logged off, even if you think you've deleted all your data, even if you think you've deleted all your account, you've signed up to give everything away. That's it, basically. You are there. They've captured you. There is no release. So, what's key, going back to the initial debate about personhood, is what we saw when we were looking at the newsfeed and when we were looking at all the AdWords was that Facebook effectively matches people most effectively who have a high profile, who have a dense and influential network, and who they have a lot of information about. And then the AdWords have a lot of big circles on their site. Interestingly, two of our most effectively matched people were both political protesters. One protests on, and yoga, and the other is a queer performance artist. But they were matched perfectly. They were absolute matches with her. But with a participant whose group, network group, is smaller, less influential, the edge rank algorithm, that's the algorithm that's used to do all the matching, couldn't make a good match at all. Really didn't work very well. But what was interesting was when there was a highly influential person with a loose network, the edge rank got very, very confused, and they kept trying to get his attention by manipulating his newsfeed, and kept trying to make him pay attention to things, but he was kind of not really interested. But, and I think this is the most significant one, with a participant with a loose network group and no influential or powerful connections, edge rank just didn't bother. Really just wasn't interested. And we thought we'd made a mistake. We thought, why is Facebook not paying attention to these people? What's going on? And then we realised who they were. They were interested. We suspect from Turow's work, and I'll go on to this, we suspect that those individuals who are not high net worth are just not being traded. There's no point, they're not going to buy things. But we suspect from Joseph Turow's work that they're likely to be remainder to be sold to debt companies. So that's most likely what's happening. We can't prove that yet, but I'm telling you, we will do some research on this in the future. If it kills me, it'll be the last thing I do. Because it's really interesting that what's happening is Facebook most effectively monetizes those who enterprise themselves. Now, I think this is really difficult, different from theories around labour and capital. So, you know, it was all about exploitation of unwilling labour. People had to work, people were being exploited. They certainly didn't align themselves with the interest of capital. What you have here is an almost perfect alignment between the middle class and capital. But interestingly, they don't get any financial benefit from it. And that's why I want to argue it's a new regime of accumulation. It exists in the world of circulation, not production. It moves money around the world without making profit. It expropriates in the tradition of almost primitive accumulation rather than exploitation. Because when it expropriates, there is no alienation, usually, from the contributions you've made. You're not alienated, usually, when you go on Facebook. And you're not being necessarily contracted for the labour, although there are proprietary rights being put around you. So the conclusions, and I have to come back to knots. I had so many knots written here when I began, I took them all out. So I think, to conclude, there are different possibilities for personhood on Facebook. We need to untangle Facebook's desire for profit, generating both compulsory individuality and individuation, from the personas given, from what people offer up. And there are debates about, is this a gift economy? Are people gifting their information? But alignments are made, value with value, person value with capital value, and the privilege to learn, I call privilege Facebook, because if you remember, it began as kind of an elite site for privileged students. Privilege to learn to extract value from themselves most effectively. So there is an irony in this. The middle class are the key source for expropriation, but at little cost to themselves. But there are old knots. Class divisions are massive, we'd argue, between the high net worth individual, as they call it, and the remainder. And as we see, if you look at all the categories that are used by data companies to define people. Urban is one of the key categories used for remainder people. And we saw that in the subprime property crisis. And urban means African American in the US. And they are the people most likely to be remaindered on Facebook, just as they were remaindered through the property crisis. So I think debt is going to be very significant. The not two to one time is that there are very different temporalities working here. It's not labour, it's live time and circulation time that are being used. And I think we need to understand the knot of entanglement as a metadata economic system. And it is an oligopoly with its ubiquitous tracking that people cannot escape from, its market testing function. It enables capital to circulate, but also, and I think this is a very important argument from Costas, who's not talking about social media, but I've just stolen his argument, that basically what Facebook does is lubricate the entry of financialization into other sectors of the economy. So Facebook has more information on people's credit through tracking them than most debt companies. It will sell that, and it will enable the spread and the contagion of financial services and securitization throughout the rest of the economy. It's circulating capital and it's circulating financialization. And that's why I want to argue it's a new regime of accumulation and alternatives to Facebook. I'm afraid they just don't have the capacity. There's been crabgrass knives. Thank you, Mark, for Diaspora and Ello. Ello failed quite drastically, I was checking out. One thing I can't decide whether it's a joke or not is there's an official anonymous page on Facebook. Doesn't sound quite right to me. But then I think I really like the World Social, which hosts Segnet, Syriza, interesting name, and all the kind of small financial organisations, probably like your Baltimore, Bitcoins, where you have different forms of circulation. So, you know, that's the kind of anonymous one on Facebook. A bit odd, so I just want to end. Yeah. It's pretty grim. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Thank you very much, Trevor, for a really interesting paper. And I suppose the big starting question that kind of comes up a lot in this paper is, I guess, how new are platforms like Facebook in the sense of how we understand the accumulation of economic value? Because, of course, there have always been specialists in the selling of services that enable the realisation of surplus value rather than its production. Advertising and market research, for example, both of which are nicely blended in the Facebook experience. And indeed, the kinds of debates about labour, production and value have resonances with much older debates in classical political economy, such as the distinction between productive and unproductive labour that some of the more senior of us in this room may still have a vague memory of from many decades ago. So where Facebook and some other online communities perhaps differ is entangling the idea of business and community, or the production of value and the consumption of value, so that boundaries that previously seemed less problematic are now increasingly unclear. Do they mean that the nature of capital is hidden within a community of friends? Or does it lead to a creation of an anxiety about the nature of the boundary and the nature of the community? And every so often there's an outbreak of anxiety across various media about this monetized nature of online community and the buying and selling of data. And as Facebook is marketed as a community, the idea that the commercial dynamic sits vampirically upon other kinds of relations and somehow turns into something else is an occasional anxiety that breaks the surface. And this is a concern that has plenty of resonances elsewhere. So to bring it, as Sarah suggested, straight to Papua New Guinea, there is a growing concern where I did my fieldwork that the ability to buy and sell customary wealth objects, such as so-called shell money, with state currency, had led to the customary relations that are cemented in these kinds of rituals, increasingly becoming viewed as a meaningless pastiche. The difference, of course, is that whereas this kind of monetization of custom can easily be presented by the anthropologist and the informant alike as the imposition of an alien financial logic into a previously non-monetized community in a Bohannon-style argument, a platform like Facebook was sold as a community of friends in which the social relations of that community were designed to be monetized right from the very start. But what's perhaps most important here is the way in which this commercial personalization of data implies the partial digitalization of the person. It ties together different strands of activity to create a digital person, closely related to the flesh and blood person, but not reducible to it, instead standing in a peculiar kind of relation to it. And here again we see a parallel with quite seemingly traditional and old-fashioned types of anthropological literature. Many of us will have read about or studied places where the person is accompanied by a non-physical companion or avatar, or who has an aspect of themselves that leaves the physical body when it is asleep or when it dies. And the creation of non-physical personae that are composites of thousands of social relationships that the person has entered into and can persistently be related to after the physical body's death is a problem raised by Facebook, but it's also a problem faced by the informants of many classical ethnographers, people who need to work out what is the nature of the person who remains in their community after death, for example, much as there has already been a large amount of writing and deliberation trying to deal with the issue of what happens to your Facebook persona after your death. And who gets them to manage and relate to that persona that might persist after you passed away. And this kind of parallel might work to tie together some of the more contemporary cutting-edge work in sociology, such as Bev is doing, with some of the more seemingly traditional kinds of anthropological analysis. This perhaps is a surprising knot that appears as we see strands of earlier problems reappearing in very different new circumstances. But the other big question here is money, and I think this ties back to Jay's paper as well. Obviously, money is at the heart of Beck's paper, as at its heart is the question of what kind of capital accumulation is possible from the extraction of information from seemingly non-commercial social relationships. The financial value in its production and circulation online take many different forms, raising again the question that Jane asked us about the creation of money and from what does financial value emerge. So online currencies, for example, most famously Bitcoin, potentially raise very different questions about the creation of financial value from online relationships, and most crucially, the kinds of persons who are created from those circulations. So in contrast to Facebook's careful construction of a billion very detailed digital personae, closely modelled on the tastes and habits of a particular flesh and blood person, browsing and buying online, for many people, Bitcoin opens up the possibility of a completely opposite, entirely anonymous person, finally liberated from the ability of society and the state to track them down. So in a recent survey, 43% of US Bitcoin users self-identified as libertarians, in contrast to around 1.5% of the US population as a whole. For these people, Bitcoin's liberatory potential is the complete opposite from the digital revolution ushered in by Facebook, as they hope the transaction can be digitally and conceptually separated from the rest of the person, enabling them to transact as pure market actors, free from state interference and other forms of tracking and social entanglement, perhaps for the first time in human history. And of course, this once again brings us back to Marx, who noted that production could be viewed as a form of consumption from certain perspectives and vice versa. And Marx predicts that productive consumption and consumptive production are two things that tie together in a giant circulation. Yeah? Marx predicted that the distinction that came from between these two things, that came from the particular organisation of production and realisation of economic value in the mid-19th century, would eventually collapse under the weight of its own contradictions. And perhaps, as has often been the case, Marx is belatedly proven to have been correct, although the form of the collapse of that distinction is taking a form that he could never have predicted or foreseen.